So Anna, we were just talking about a topic that often comes up in both of our sort of niche fields, I believe, when it comes to stress and how people approach stress in their physical body, especially the neck area. And that affects not only your overall mobility, but I feel like it affects how you approach meditation. So why don't you share what you were just saying before I hit record?
Of course. So, stress, obviously most of the time it presents as tension in your body. And one of the most common things that I see people do, I see this myself as well. As soon as I'm starting to get stressed or anxious, you see that? Like my ears are going up towards my shoulders are going up towards my ears. So I'm like right here and I'm super tense. I'm super anxious. And it's really hard to breathe here. It's harder to think, and obviously it's harder to relax. And like there's like a lot of ways we can try and like wiggle out of that position. But what most people don't know about, and this is what I love teaching clients as well, is that we can kind of give ourselves a massage a little bit and use targeted tissue release to focus on the muscles that need that little release. And then we are going to be able to feel the entire area relax, and we are going to be able to breathe better, and we are going to be able to kind of get ourselves in a more relaxed mind frame as well, because it's all connected.
Yeah, it is. And you were talking about the muscles and the scrunching up, and particularly, working at the computer all day. But that seems to be another indicator, as you've mentioned, that you've triggered stress in your body. And I know from what my conversations have been with you that sometimes you were unconscious of it until someone pointed it out. And I've had people many times in my lifetime tell me, "Oh, what's going on here?" So what can we do? Like, what's a quick little win for that?
Yeah, so like it's super quick to release. And the nice thing about it, if you release this area, you are going to feel less stressed, but also this area, whenever we have trigger points, it's all connected, like it's connected to your jaw stress as well. So if you're like clenching your jaw a lot, so like if you're like grinding your teeth, it all goes in there. So it can help you, like this entire area is interconnected. So this one trick can really help you out. So all we are going to do, and it's super easy, and you can do it at home. You don't need anything. You need your two fingers. And with those two fingers, we are going to find that shrugging muscle. And if you're having a hard time finding it, you can literally just shrug up a little bit and you're going to feel it tense up. It's going to be a little bit to the back. So it's on the side of my neck and a little bit to the back. So it's not too super far in the front. It's a little bit to the back. And I'm going to take those two fingers and I'm going to pretend that I'm just taking this arm and I'm just going to hang it on there. Because if you see what happened, I'm shrugging. I'm going to just hang it on there, and I don't have to apply too much extra pressure. I'm just going to, as if it's a coat, I'm hanging it up there. I have that tiny little pressure on there. If you need more, you can always increase it, but start with something that's very gentle. And then once we have that, we are going to relax the other arm, and then we are going to do head tilts. So here I'm just very slowly maintaining that pressure, relax the other arm as well. We are going to do those tilts, and the entire body is relaxed. Don't tense into your fingers, let the muscle relax. And after about 4 to 5 of these movements, we are going to feel that area relaxing. And once we are done with the tilts, then we are going to do your twists. So it looks like I'm just looking over to the side. I still have that gentle pressure. Everything is relaxed. And you should already feel like that muscle is letting go. All that we are doing right now is we are helping that muscle relax by maintaining that pressure with the movement. So once here, if you want to go into your usual stretches, or if you just want to go into your usual breathing exercises, you have already released that muscle a little bit, so it's going to be easier.
That is so relaxing. Every time we've done these little exercises together, I feel it. Now, Is it important to balance? Let's say you over relax one part and then forget the other. That can that affect you in a negative way?
Yeah, of course it can affect you, and a lot of times that is what happens when we have a postural imbalance that we don't like. What happens is that one muscle is taking on too much, and it's not necessarily because you want to make it tense or if you want to get it want it to get in that position, but they tend to take over from other muscles that are weaker, and this can happen all around your body. So this can affect a lot of different areas. And especially for this one that I just showed you, if these muscles here are very, very tight and tense, that can actually give you some back pain a little bit lower on your back as well. Or it can give you that tightness in your jaw. It can give you those tension headaches. So if we let those muscles relax, it's going to help that immediate area. And also everything that's connected to it. And it's going to help you get back into a more ideal type of posture, and through that, a more ideal type of movement.
Now, you've covered a lot of great tips here, and it's all connected to our neck posture as well, and that ties in a lot with meditation. So first, give me the fundamentals, how your neck posture should be.
Yeah, so this is the one that I struggle with the most too, and I want to point out before anybody freaks out and starts overanalyzing it that our posture is usually not perfect, and there's always something that we can work on, and how tired we are or what we have been doing that day. If you've been on your phone a lot, if you've been on your computer a lot, even during the day, your posture can change a lot. And
And
that's
this
why.
sounds like change of culture, right? Like we're like this.
And that's what you see, like wherever you go, everybody is on their phones, right? So the more you see this posture, the more you're going to be able to identify it in yourself as well. And it's not criticism, it's awareness, because the first part of being able to change your posture is being aware of it. So I'm going to show you this forward head posture, what we talk about when it happens. Like, just pretend that I'm on my phone. And I kind of go like this, right? Like, I don't know if you can see it. So I have my head forward. So like my ears, they are not on the same line as my shoulders. And I can bring this back, but for a lot of people, that's not as easy as it seems. If I just tell you, just pull your head back, what happens a lot of times is they start looking up. So they turn their neck up, or they do the other variation. They bring their chin down to their chest and like, okay, my head is back now. Are we cool? No, we are not. So what we want to do, it's called a chin tuck. It's not a very flattering movement, but it's a way to reinforce that posture and get back to neutral. Because what we want to get back in this is really your neutral neck position. And I will show you in a second. So from the forward head position, the way I want you to imagine this in your mind is that we are just going to pretend that there's something in front of us and it's coming closer and we don't want to touch it. And we are not going to move up or down. We are just going to move back. So what that looks like from the side, when I'm here, I'm in my forward head position and I have that thing that I don't want to touch. It's coming, it's coming, it's coming. And I'm going to activate here. I have some deep neck flexors inside. So that's what you're going to feel like. It's inside your neck. You're going to activate there and you're going to pull back to neutral. And here, if you look like you have a little bit of a double chin, that's fine. That's okay. That's just from this posture. If I push my head to the front, like, you know, it might look better, but eventually what we want to be is be able to get into that neutral neck position, because that's going to be the position that's going to protect your neck the most, especially if you're doing exercises, especially if you're maintaining a forward neck posture a lot when you're on your phone, when you're working. You want to come back to neutral and you want to be able to create that awareness and create that feeling, what it feels like for me to be in neutral.
So you're saying that we're activating something internal, we're not actually doing it forward or backward movement physically.
Yeah, so it's not like I'm trying to push my head back with my hand, and this is something that I get asked often, like, oh, my neck won't move, or my hand doesn't want to move there. Can I move it with my other hand, or can I like force my head back? And that's kind of the point, that I don't want you to have an external force. I want you to feel into how to use the right muscles. And remember, we talked about the ones that are overstressed and the ones that are kind of turned off because the other ones have taken over. So what we want to do now is find those muscles that should be working, but they have been offline a little bit, and tell them, hey, I need you. I need you to do what you do. So when we get back in that position, and that might be a new feeling for a lot of people to feel those. They are called deep neck flexors. It might be a new type of sensation to feel those coming back online, because they are, a lot of times they are just so underused, and a lot of other areas are taking over. But when you learn to get back in that position, then you can strengthen that, and then you are going to be able to build on that. And it's going to be easier and easier, and you are going to be able to maintain that posture longer and longer.
Right. What are the different practices that you know of, and which one of those do you think that we could in integrate during the holidays even?
Well, especially during the holidays when stress tends to run a little bit higher, but these techniques apply, any time that you need it. And the more you make it a part of your regular routine, the more lasting results you are going to get. So the tissue release that I showed you, we can do tissue release on different parts of the body. Even just when it comes to the neck, we can do it on different parts, and that's an immediate release. But it also helps you if you want to do more stretches. It helps you if you want to be more mindful, because if you're trying to be mindful, if you're trying to focus on your thoughts, but what you're feeling is your body being tense, that takes you right out of it, right? If you can relax, then you are going to be able to breathe properly. So that will help you with mindfulness. That will help you with exercise. If you want to be more active, if you want to be doing your exercises regularly, but you have all of these imbalances, all of the muscles that are stressed that are not supposed to be, all of the muscles that are offline that are supposed to be online, you can work really hard. You can stay at the gym for long hours. You can go hard at it. But if you're not using your muscles the way that they are supposed to be used, you are not going to get the results that you want. And worse, you are risking a possible injury, which is going to cause even more stress, which is going to cause you to feel like you're even more behind. So it's very important for you to be able to stay on those techniques. And especially if you're stressed and you feel like, oh, I don't have those couple minutes to do my tissue release, that's when you need it especially.
And this also helps you with the fundamentals of having a decent meditation practice. Because often I've seen people say, well, I can't sit still, or my body's too restless. Well, it may not be necessarily that you can't sit. It's like you haven't trained those, you haven't, what do you call it? Turning on the things
Turning
that
around
are.
the muscles that are offline.
Yeah, I love that expression. So let's say you learn how to turn those on. That may be the fundamental step to then turn on the way to truly relax and turn on your, what do they call it? The parasympathetic system, right?
Yeah.
So, and that is the, I would say, the fundamentals of a good meditation. We've talked about neck posture meditation as well. My basic formula for a good meditation is having your feet flat on the ground and your body perpendicular. Essentially, you're seated with your spine straight. Now, that would often be very difficult for most people if their neck is tense or their shoulders are hunched up. All the things you listed would first help you really turn on that ability to relax the internal muscles. Now, once you're there's a series of things you could do to then go into the meditation. But before I go there, What are some of the things that you've noticed during the, not just the holidays, but in general, where the clock upstairs, the thoughts, the monkey mind won't turn down? What are the things that often trigger them, and how do you believe meditation can help?
Well, I believe that, stress accumulates. So the more stress you experience, it's not like, oh, like I'm stressed about one thing, and then if I add another thing that I'm stressed about, I'm twice as stressed. You might feel like you're like three times as stressed, or even more. And the more things you worry about, and the more things that add on, and especially when the holidays are coming around, you might be worried about a lot of different family related issues, travel, finances. You're definitely probably worried about nutrition. I hear this a lot. Worries about eating when it comes to the holidays. I don't know if I am able to have control. I feel like I'm going to eat too much. There's too many feelings involved. There's too much that comes up. I don't know how to deal with other people's reactions to something that I want to do or something that I don't want to do when it comes to my nutrition. So all of these things, when you are able to manage your stress overall, you are going to be able to decrease that feeling of being crowded in your mind. So that's why, like, when it comes to your approach, for example, to nutrition, you don't necessarily want to add more rules for yourself when it comes to the holidays. You might not want to. I know there's a feeling like, oh, I have to double down and I have to be like even more focused, but you could actually take it back and think about, okay, how do I feel and how can I make this stressful time of the year be a little bit less stressful? How can I focus on maybe even feeling a little bit joyful around this time of year?
Yeah, and often overwhelm is one of the things that I've seen, not in, only in myself, but in others. And that overwhelm can then translate into all areas of your life. Like you said, you don't know how stressed you are until it's sometimes almost too late. But the stress could be then manifesting in terms of the food choices you make and how much you eat. And it may not be necessarily that you want to even eat that extra chip out of the bag.
Exactly. All of it is, it's about when it comes to stress and its effect on how you move and how you exist and how you eat. It's coming back to that feeling of being able to be present. And that's where, you can practice that in your meditation and it can help you a lot. And you can also practice it by being able to relax. Because if you have all of those thoughts, your body is reacting to it. And after a while, it starts to become a thing in your posture. I mean, you can wind that back. It's almost like you can take that stress off, you can take that time off. And when you're thinking about nutrition, for example, especially around the holidays, a lot of times it feels like I can't be present with my family because I'm thinking about the calories. I'm thinking about, oh, how much exercise I'm going to have to do if I eat this. And if you're thinking about that, you're not there in the present. And the problem with that is, you are not going to remember how many calories you ate. You're not going to remember that. What you're going to remember is that time that you shared with the people that were important for you. And if
Yeah.
you're not able to be there for that, then you're not able to show up for your life.
Yeah.
And that's the same reason why we meditate too, right? To be able to slow down a little bit, to be able to focus on the right things. And that's how it also ties into exercise. Like if I'm able to focus on the right muscles, I might don't need to do as much as I think I need to. I might not need to go as hard as I think I need to if I'm able to target the things that I need. So all of it is really getting that ability in your mind, in your body, and I believe with you, Shilpa, with your in your spirit too, right? To be able to show up for your life.
And I did so sincerely appreciate the language you use to articulate that concept of being aware and being present, not only in your physical body, like the neck movement you're showing, and being aware that, oh wow, there's something going on internally there. The same thing is with meditation, is that we're in a society often where it's so go, go, go that you're rewarded for going, but you're not rewarded for slowing down in your internal clock. In the meditation practice, which has taken me years to do, and I still call myself a practitioner, it is the case that when my body is stressed, my body is not relaxed, that I am not able to then go silent or go still. And so I have this, the three S's when it comes to meditation. You create the space first. Then you create the silence. And from the silence, you come to the place of stillness. And there's so much peace there. And I believe it's probably true for the physical body as well. You have to create the space for it, right?
Absolutely. And I can't even tell you how often this happens, that, and this is why I like really focusing on the building blocks of, you know, we can say posture, but when I say that, really the building blocks of function and being able to be aware and be aware of what it feels like in your body to get into those optimal working positions. It happens so often that, for example, if I work with somebody on core engagement, and they will tell me, you know, I've been going to yoga classes for years, I've been doing exercise for years, and this is the first time that now I'm actually able to feel what it feels like when my core is working. And that's really what I mean, is that if you don't go over those fundamental things, and for this, you need to slow down. Because the first things that you practice for your neck position, for your core position, is going to be those small movements where you just feel what it feels like on the inside. And if somebody is looking into your room when you're exercising, they will be like, they are not even moving. Like, what are they doing in here? But that's that outside judgment where, you know, you have to do the big things, the flashy things, the big movements. But really what you want to be able to do is have the awareness and be able to focus internally and feel what it feels like in your body to be in the right positions.
And that is the same point I would make when it comes to going inside of your heart or your spirit. Feel like what it feels like. And sometimes it takes weeks or days. It's like an ocean wave that comes in, and sometimes you're feeling the wave and you're feeling peace. But if you lose that connection, then you're sort of drifted out away from that movement of peace. And so you don't feel like what it feels like. For those of the people that have told me, for those of who have expressed that they don't feel like they can meditate, it's because they haven't felt what it felt like to just close their eyes, feel their breath. And it's almost analogous, because it's, we are just some, you know, holistically a one being.
We are, and one area that you focus on can definitely affect the other. So especially if somebody is interested in making their meditations more effective, just focusing on creating that same type of awareness and learning their body positions and learning how to control their breathing, that is all going to tie in together. But then they are not only going to be able to see improvements in their meditation, they are going to be able to see improvements in how they move on the daily. And that's going to affect how they show up, like how do they feel in their body? How do they interact with other people? How brave they are when they have to lift their child or lift their dog, or, like, you know, it's like everything that you do, you exist in this body and you exist in this experience. And thinking that you can just ignore one part and just try to, like, push the other parts to overwork it, that's the exact same idea, that we can just focus on on those muscles that are being stressed and just expect an overall well-working body. We have to focus on everything, and we have to release the areas that need releasing, and we have to strengthen the areas that need strengthening. And then we are going to have a well-oiled entire organism that is able to be present, and it's able to function as it's intended.
And functioning as desired is really a body, mind, spirit, the whole package. Like you were saying, if you can't even lift your child, and you've been focusing on other facets of your life, then you may realize, okay, like my case, I would have sciatic nerve pain, which then made it difficult to sit in meditation for a long time. So one affects the other. One of my favorite sayings is, where attention goes, energy flows. And in this case, I would say give the attention holistically to yourself, to your energy of your body, to energy of going internal, to your spirit through meditation and other breathwork techniques. And also, like, going back to the element of nourishment and food, which there's such a stigma at times of nourishment. And I think the word nourishment actually gives it a better connotation, because you're really talking about how to enrich the body.
Exactly. And, you know, there's just so much guilt that can be created around nutrition that's really unnecessary. You know, if you imagine, like, maybe like 100 years in the future, when you finally have reached the end of your life, and, you know, what do you want people to say about you? And everybody's going to be saying, oh my God, she weighed I don't know how many pounds. And like that's not what you want your accomplishment to be. That's not what you want your life to be. That's not what you want people to remember about you. So why is it that you make your self-worth dependent on that? It's because we are carrying all of this guilt and all of this shame, and it's so hard to put it down. And it affects so many little decisions and so many considerations that we make. And just like I said, like, when you're not able to be present with your family at the table, it's affecting your nutrition. It's affecting your relationships. It's affecting everything about your life. And it's not just that one area of your life. It's all interconnected. So when you're able to practice and switch into a different mindset and be able to put that stress down, and give significance to the things that are actually going to enrich your life, then you are going to find that you have more energy, you have more time to focus on the things that are important.
So, Anna, I really feel like we've kind of covered all areas. And one thing I think that the audience would love to know is that you've actually created a particular series on posture.
Yes, that's correct. So posture and mobility, but really the way I want you to think about it is function and relief, is what really is going to happen in your life. That's the way I intended to make these programs, is that you are going to feel relief. You are going to create that awareness, and then you can go on. And if you want to up-level your workouts, if you want to just feel more functional in your life, it's going to give you a good foundation. And I call these my Shaped by Strength foundations, exactly, because they come in as the first step. And the first one that I created is actually about neck posture, because, like I said, that's the hardest one for me. I worked on it for myself as well. And it's one of the most common complaints that I hear from other people as well. So what I wanted to create is something that is going to provide you with relief, and then it's going to provide you with that targeted strengthening so you can reinforce the good posture. So that is my neck function fix program in my Shaped by Strength Foundation series.
That is wonderful. And I believe that once you have gone through that series, so you and I have been practicing it in our, you know, past podcasts, or you've shared a lot about it with me in terms of the neck and the overall stretching importance. The posture for the neck is so integral for the meditation practice. And again, one may practice it seated. Often some people say they do laying down. But I come from a school of thinking where it is most optimal to meditate seated with the posture at a 90-degree angle. And this is where your energy can flow optimally. So for anyone that's interested in kind of learning a more softer approach to awareness of the whole body through meditation, I would check out my 5-day meditation challenge that I'll be launching in December. So,
Yeah, I'm
Anna,
going to be taking on that challenge because I feel like I need more of this in my life.
and I'll take on your challenge because I always need better posture for my neck. Well, thank you, Anna, and I know we'll do more of these series in the near future.
Thank you so much, Shilpa.
Take care. Bye.
Bye.